There are fears of mass casualties after Russia bombed a theatre where up to 1,200 civilians were sheltering in Ukraine. It comes just hours after the Ukrainian president delivered an impassioned plea for help to the US Congress.
The President Biden, being the leader of the world, means to be the leader of peace.
Let's go live to non-correspondent Amelia Adams, who is in the Ukrainian city of Lviv. Amelia, good morning to you. What do we know about this latest attack?
Yeah, just truly awful, Carl, in the last couple of hours. As you say, it was a community drama theatre in Mariupol, which has been besieged, cut off for weeks. That city, no food, no power, no water. So many people have lost their homes to Russian shelling that a lot of them were actually sheltering in this drama theatre when a Russian aircraft dropped a bomb on it. So the reports coming out at this early stage are that there are at least 1,000 people, including a lot of children, who are sheltering inside that theatre. And you can see from the images, it's basically been split in half. It's been decimated. Mariupol is truly a human hellhole. There are not a lot of buildings left standing there. One of them still standing. There's a hospital, and it's now completely overflowing with bodies. So these are the stories and the images that Ukraine's President Volodymyr Zelensky took to US Congress today, or he zoomed in to Capitol Hill. And he really put this word in terms Americans can relate to, invoking America's own past horrors.
Remember Pearl Harbor. Remember September the 11th, when evil tried to turn your cities, independent territories, in battlefields, when innocent people were attacked from air. Our country experience the same every day, right now.
Yeah, it was a really powerful speech, and he received a standing ovation from Congress. But he wants more than applause. He wants more sanctions on Russia. He wants a no-fly zone over Ukraine. He wants foreign fighter jets here. Those are things NATO continues to say will not be happening, certainly not a no-fly zone at least, because NATO does not want to be drawn into a war with Russia. I guess the only little bit of positive glimmer of hope I could deliver you this morning, Carl, is that officials from both Russia and Ukraine have said today there's cautious optimism. That's a language they're using, that peace talks are making some progress towards ending what's now been nearly 3 weeks of an horrific and deadly war.
Let's talk again to Ukrainian MP Dmytro Gurin, who joins us now. Dmytro, thank you so much again for your time. I know you've got plenty on your plate right now. There are fears of yet another atrocity with the bombing of this theatre sheltering 1,000 civilians. Are you able to shed any more light on casualty numbers and how that situation is?
We don't know yet how many casualties and how many dead in the theatre. First of all, because a lot of people are under rests of the building, and we just don't know yet. And the works to save these people, they cannot be started because, you know, shelling never stops, and artillery still works in Mariupol all the time. That we can say is that at 2 o'clock, at 14:00, we had live on Ukrainian television that the person who saved from Mariupol, who went out from Mariupol, he said that in a dramatic theater there is a bomb shelter, and a lot of people, mostly women with children, are in this bomb shelter. And in 20 minutes after this video on the all Ukrainian channels, in 20 minutes, airplane dropped a bomb on dramatic theater. And, you know, it's very classic theater, you know, very classic building with columns. And you cannot think even from airplane that it's military infrastructure. So they just knew that that is bomb shelter and dropped a 1,000 kilo bomb on this dramatic theater, and the building is destroyed now.
There you go. Look at that photo there. It says everything, doesn't it? Look, meantime, President Zelensky addressed the US Congress overnight, asking Americans to remember Pearl Harbor and 9/11 as he called for more help. He got a standing ovation. But Dmytro, Ukraine needs more than applause right now, right?
Mr. Zelensky tells American Congress and American people about Pearl Harbor and other cases in American history, because now, you know, all of this were for America. It was not only the question of people, the question of lives. It was also the question of humanity, the question of civilization at all. And now what's going on in Mariupol, it's also the question of humanity, not just not the war, because 3 weeks ago the war started. We had ordinary war, army against army, and all the world could see that Ukraine can beat Russia on the battlefield, and everybody seen it. And so they changed tactics, and they decided if we all resist, so let's kill them all. And what's going on in Mariupol? It's medieval siege. They mined all the fields around the city. They mined roads from the city, and they destroyed all the communication, the heating, electricity, water, gas. There is no food in the city, there is no water. People melt snow for making water. They use water from radiator system, and they prepare food on an open fire near the buildings. And you know, it's not like barbecue near the private one's building. It's people who live in 9-story buildings, the classic blocks. And my building where I grew up and lived for 15 years, it was shot by tank and totally burned all the 200 apartments. So it's not the war anymore, it's just mass murdering. And we understand that the goal of Russia in Mariupol is to start a hunger, because in this humanitarian corridor went out 20,000 people, and 350,000 stayed in Mariupol.
Oh, it's unbelievable. So I can't fathom. I'm sorry, Dmytro, you're cutting in and out there. We'll have to leave it there for the moment. But you have all of our prayers at the moment, and as does the whole country. Thank you.
I mean, this is terrible, just hearing this morning of these 1,200 civilians who were in the theatre, which has just been bombed. No word as yet as to you know, number of casualties. But, I mean, that's the point here, isn't it? Civilians are again paying the heaviest price in this conflict.
Yes, I mean, I've seen the reports as well. We also are not able to confirm any figures. I've seen the reports just as you have, but it is indicative of what we have seen over the course of the last week or more than a week in Mariupol, of civilian areas that have been bombed, residential areas. And as you said, it's civilians are paying the price for this war. And it shows that the rules of war have not always been respected. The rules of war include civilians being able to find safe passage to get out of harm's way, but also if staying in their homes, they deserve to be protected. Structures like hospitals are meant to be protected. And we've seen many times already in Mariupol that these rules of war have not always been observed.
It's just terrible watching some of this vision come in, truly awful, and watching emergency services try and save people while the bombs are raining down around them. What's the situation in hospitals like with so many casualties?
It's incredibly complex, and it's getting harder by the day. We are in touch with hospitals all over the country, in Kyiv, in Kharkiv. We were in touch with the hospitals in Mariupol until communications were cut, so we haven't had communication with them for over a week now. We're incredibly worried about the situation there. Obviously, we've all seen the footage of one of the hospitals receiving a shelling, destroying the maternity ward. The last communication we had, which was over a week ago, was them communicating that they are receiving high numbers of wounded and they're running out of supply. Since then, we lost contact and we haven't been able to get any supply in. We haven't heard of others who've been able to get supply in. So the situation could be incredibly dire, but we are unable to confirm it at this time.
Mm. And are you hearing anything? I mean, we're reading that people are running out of food, water, medical supplies, even people breaking into heating systems to access the water there. Are you hearing those reports, and that, you know, some people are actually dying because they can't access medical help, or they're starving?
Yes, we are. We have staff, colleagues of ours who work for MSF, who are currently in Mariupol, who have been able to communicate to us when they can. That communication has been getting harder and harder as the days go by. But they have communicated exactly these things, that people have started dying due to lack of access to medical care, people who had existing conditions, people who need access to insulin, hemodialysis, women who need access to safe birthing. People have died because of the violence and the shelling. And people will start dying of dehydration and hunger if they haven't already, because you have a population of almost 400,000 people who are cut off from access to clean water and food.
Little bubbers. Yeah. Little bubbers. Oh.
It breaks your heart, doesn't it? Mm. Look, Alex, we really appreciate your time and the efforts for your organisation on the ground there. Mm. Thank you for your time this morning.
Thank you.